here from North Capitol Street and the District of Columbia. It is a thrill and a profound honor to have them with us this afternoon. My name is Professor Joseph Prudhomme, and I teach in the Department of Political Science and also in Religious Studies, and I'm the Director of the Institute for Religion, Politics, and Culture at Washington College. The Institute is an academic program that explores the historic and ongoing contributions of religion to political and cultural flourishing in the United States and around the world. The Institute sponsors a distinguished speaker series, houses a peer-reviewed book series, publishing works of some of the brightest minds working on issues at the intersection of religion and public life. It sponsors interdisciplinary courses, such as the course that we're teaching this semester on religion and architecture. And it has international partnerships with the University of Oxford, the University of Rome, and across Europe. Well, the Institute can be followed if you're interested online. And please note that we also have an event coming up a week from tomorrow, Tuesday, May the 3rd, when we welcome an award-winning architect and professor of architecture, Duncan Stroik, to discuss the intersection of religion and architecture in an address titled The Biblical Foundations of Sacred Architecture. That event is Tuesday, May the 3rd at 6 p.m. in this very room. But to the matter at hand. Tonight, it is my great honor to introduce Dr. John Borelli. Dr. Borelli has a doctorate in religious studies from Fordham and has worked in the area of interfaith relations for decades with the U.S. Conference of Catholic Bishops and currently as the special advisor to the president of Georgetown University for interfaith initiatives. We are thrilled to have him here this evening to speak about Nostra, Aetate, a document that bespeaks the tremendous and ongoing importance of interreligious solidarity and brotherhood. But before I begin, our president, Dr. Sheila Baer, has asked me to say a few remarks on her behalf. Unfortunately, she is not able to be with us this evening, but she commanded me sternly to extend to you her very warmest wishes and to read the following statement on her behalf. President Sheila Baer, on behalf of Washington College, I'm delighted that the Institute for Religion, Politics, and Culture is sponsoring this important event. I wish to extend my deep thanks to the Institute, Mr. Fred Israel, Dr. John Borelli, Cantor Alan Haber, and the Gospel Choir of St. Martin's Church for being on campus and sharing their time, talents, and inspiring ideas with the Washington College community. The topic of interreligious solidarity is vitally important in today's world, and this event is most welcome. As a campus community of engaged, globally minded students from a diverse array of backgrounds, Washington College strives to encourage precisely the kind of respectful attention to religious and cultural differences this talk provides, while also inspiring students to work together for the common good. I am so sorry my hectic schedule has not allowed me to be with you this evening, but once again, I'm so honored to have this event here on the heart of our beloved campus. A note from our president, who unfortunately is in New York today. I also want to say before we begin, just one brief statement on behalf of our very dear friend, Mr. Fred Israel. Mr. Fred Israel is the spiritual architect of this event tonight, a renowned attorney, a legendary political consultant, and a former member of the board at Georgetown University, thank you, and Wheeling Jesuit University, a man whose vision is everywhere this evening. No one better exemplifies the spirit of interfaith solidarity than our very good friend, Mr. Fred Israel. He unfortunately is very ill this evening, but I have been told that he anticipates a full recovery, and he extends his very best wishes with the following note, that Fred asked me to remind you all of the legacy of three individuals. First, of Thomas Kennedy. Thomas Kennedy was a legislator from Maryland in the early 19th century. In the early 19th century, it was illegal for Jews to occupy positions of public trust under the government of Maryland. and Thomas Kennedy, a devout Christian, believed that this was unjust. And he worked tirelessly over the course of 10 years to have that law changed. And in memory of Thomas Kennedy, Fred asks us to remember the importance of interfaith solidarity to other people. Eleanor Roosevelt. Eleanor Roosevelt wrote in 1947 in the Coronet magazine an article entitled "Toleration is an Ugly Word," in which she argued that what we should do is not merely tolerate others who are different from us as if they were some toxin or poison that we have to simply live with, but rather to embrace and to cherish our differences. And lastly, Archbishop Montini of Milan, a man for whom the word brotherhood and friendship among the world's religions was central, a driving force along with Roncalli. These are Montini, the late, who would later become Paul VI, and Roncalli, John the 23rd, are individuals about whom our speaker will explore with us together this evening the importance of these men for interfaith solidarity. So, with those words from Fred Israel and from President Sheila Baird, let me now welcome Dr. John Borelli. Thank you.
Great. Thank you very much, Joseph. And thanks to Fred, a dear friend I've known through Georgetown University these years. And also, I've never spoken after such a terrific choir has sung. You've put me in a hole, so I've got to really do well just to catch up with that marvelous, marvelous beginning from the choir of St. Martin's. Now, as I look at the audience tonight, there are two groups of you here. There are those who look at this title and say, what does this mean? I mean, I don't have a clue. You're much like the husband who came home to the note from his wife on the refrigerator door. It said, it's empty. I can't take it anymore. I need more in my life. I'm leaving you. He opened the refrigerator and it was full. I'll have to get you older folks with something else a little later. All right, Nostra Aetate was the shortest of 16 documents of the Second Vatican Ecumenical Council, and by many accounts, the most controversial among them. It takes its name, the texts were all written in Latin. It takes its name from the first two Latin words, Nostra and Aetate, which mean in our time. No account of this can begin without reference to Pope John the 23rd. And perhaps the best way today to introduce John the 23rd to the young people in this audience is to put his photo alongside of Pope Francis. Both were surprises. Both were elderly in their late 70s when they were elected. Both began immediately breaking with traditions. Both had suffered under suspicion in previous years. Both were loved by the people, while support for them among those surrounding the office of the Pope was slower to develop. How you might feel about Pope Francis is how ordinary Catholics, those older folks here, felt in the late 1950s about Pope John. On the 50th anniversary of Pope John's passing, Pope Francis said this about this great man. 50 years after his death, the wise and fatherly guidance of Pope John, his love for the Church's tradition, and his awareness of the constant need for renewal, his prophetic intuition of the convocation of the Second Vatican Council, and his offering of his life for its success stand as milestones in the history of the Church. In the 20th century, and as a bright beacon for the journey of, that lies ahead, Pope Francis, June 3rd, 2013. Pope John died on June 3rd. 1963. A surprise choice. Both men, by the way, are known for their humor, too. Pope John would tell jokes on himself. He had been the papal ambassador in Turkey, Constantinople, during the Second World War. And when Paris was liberated, General de Gaulle, the head of the Free French Forces, demanded a new papal nuncio because he thought the old one had been complicit with Nazi occupation and the Pétain regime, the puppet regime. So Pope John gets a telegram in Constantinople. You've been assigned to Paris. Paris was the top job in those days for papal nuncios, like the United States is today. He passes through Rome on his way to Paris, and he goes to the Department of State, the Secretary of State. I can't imagine, he says to Tardini, the Secretary of State, I can't imagine myself as nuncio to Paris. He said, we can't either. The one we offered it to turned it down. So you got to go. He went. So a surprise choice. He was elected on October 28, 1958. Angelo Giuseppe Roncalli further amazed Catholics and interested observers when he broke with centuries of tradition and chose the name of John, John the 23rd. There had been a John the 23rd that only a few years earlier they decided was an antipope, wasn't really an authentic pope. So that was a sign. We didn't know at the time. Then, not quite 3 months later, he surprised the world when he announced that he intended to convoke a universal council of the church. That council would be called Vatican II. There had been 20 such general councils of the church, as Catholics number them today. The 20th was Vatican I. In 1870, Pius IX suspended Vatican I, and the bishops fled Rome as Garibaldi's Italian forces moved towards Rome in a final drive to unify Italy. Research has shown that Pius XI and Pius XII, Pope John's immediate predecessors, had initiated confidential studies about reconvening Vatican I. But in another surprise, Pope John made clear by July 14th, 6 months later, that this was not reconvening Vatican I, this was convoking Vatican II. That business is over. Then the Pope realized this, and so he said, I want to see those files. Well, they couldn't find Pius XI's files. Finally, they found them in a closet underneath a stairway in the Vatican Library. The announcement by Pope John the 23rd and his intention to convoke the council was in private to the cardinals who had gathered with him to celebrate the close of Church Unity Octave in the Basilica of St. Paul outside the walls in Rome on January 25, 1959. L'Osservatore Romano, the Vatican newspaper, published his announcement the next day, explaining the council will be of service not only for the spiritual good and joy of the Christian people, but also as an invitation to separated communities to seek that unity for which so many souls are longing in these days throughout the world. So Pope John had ecumenical intentions for his council, hoping that it would serve to improve steps towards the restoration of unity among Christians. We have not said anything yet about his interest in improving relations with Jews and more broadly interreligious relations. This is how it began. Eventually, between the announcement of January 1959 and the opening of the council in October 62, three distinct purposes articulated by Pope John were known: a spiritual renewal of the entire Christian people, reconciliation of the church to the modern world, and the renewed cordial invitation to Christian unity. 2 months later, Pope John did something else quite surprising. On Good Friday, the 28th of March, 1959, before the service for Good Friday began, he called the missal over and scratched out the Latin words for perfidious and perfidy in the prayer for the Jews for Good Friday. On Good Friday service, we have these great prayers for various communities around the world, and there was a prayer for the Jews, but we prayed for the perfidious, the disingenuous believing, the shifty Jews known for their deceit. Now, in the 50s, they said you can translate the word unfaithful too if you want to. Wasn't much of an improvement. He scratched it out. What? You can't write in the missal. I'm the Pope. I'm going to write in it. Pope John, and this caught the attraction of Jewish leaders around the world. Pope John made good on his intention to make the council ecumenical, that is, serving the unity of Christians, because he created a secretariat for promoting Christian unity among the preparatory commissions. This was on the June the 5th, 1960. And there's Cardinal Bea. He makes him the head of it. He is a Jesuit. He is highly respected. He's elderly, like Pope John, in his 70s. Both were born in 1881. He was a scholar of the Bible, the Jewish scriptures. He had been rector of the Biblicum, the Biblical College in Rome. Now, this man right here, the one that looks like a deer in headlights, he's an American. He's 30 years old. His order had sent him to Europe from America, United States. His name is Thomas Stransky. He translated that text that you have in front of you. So if you don't have a copy, make sure you have one so you can have a reference to it. That one page, table in the back, and there's copies. He's the one who translated. He's still alive. He's 85. They sent him to Europe to get him out of their hair. He's too precocious. And he calls back, I've been asked to be on this thing called the Secretariat for Promoting Christian, ground floor of Vatican II. And Cardinal Villebrons is next to him, the future Cardinal Villebrons, sorry. The future, gosh, I'll get this down. Future Cardinal Villebrons there, who took over from Cardinal Bea. Okay, so a little over a week after the announcement of this secretariat, the 83-year-old French Jewish scholar, Jules Isaac, arrived in Rome. Quote, until that day, it had not occurred to Pope John that the council had to deal also with the Jewish question and anti-Semitism. But from that day on, he was completely taken by it. Now, these are words from a brief memo dated the 14th of March, 1966, after the council is over, barely 3 months, by Monsignor Loris Capovilla. There he is today. He's 100 years old. He's now a cardinal. He was Pope John's secretary. And he writes to Father Schmidt, a Jesuit, who was Cardinal Bea's secretary, and explained this. It hadn't occurred to Pope John, but he meets Jules Isaac, and the Pope has Jules Isaac meet Cardinal Bea 2 days later. He directed Isaac to Bea. And a few days later, Bea begins his work, and finally in September, 3 months later, he finally meets Pope John to go over the work ahead, and finally he says, and I choose these words carefully, I think my secretariat could also facilitate relations with Jews in the preparation for the council. That's all. That's all the papal mandate was, facilitate relations with Jews in the preparations of the council. In September 1960, no one knew if the secretariat would have the authority to prepare its own drafts, for it had been created in the first place to be a liaison with the Christian community. No one knew at that early point when the council would begin or how long it would last. Back in September 1960, Cardinal Bea, on the end there, had no idea that when he would present the first draft of a text on the Jews in November 1963 to the 2,500 bishops and heads of religious orders gathered in St. Peter's that only he of these three 80-year-old men would still be alive. That is how fragile the origin of this text is. It's a what if that meeting had never happened. I don't think we'd have the text if that meeting had not happened. But look, let's look at what is. I suggest that besides the question on the Jews, the primary effort, which you can read about in an excellent book by John Connolly, From Enemy to Brother, Harvard University Press, 2012, where he looks at the 30 years before Vatican II and the cadre of people at work trying to change the horrible teaching of contempt for Jews that was prevalent in the church. But besides them, there was a smaller cadre of people working on a more positive assessment of Muslims and Islam. You would find them in the missionary orders of the missionaries of Africa, the White Fathers, Père Blanc, or at the Pontifical University in Rome. As early as 1924, Monsignor Paolo Mola, a Turk convert to Catholicism, began teaching courses on Islam at the Pontifical Oriental Institute. There was a positive course on Islam in Rome long before there was a positive course on Judaism, other than the Old Testament or Old Testament Judaism. And during this time, Louis Massignon was the most famous Catholic scholar of Islam, who influenced many, I think I've got his photo, yes, who influenced many to think more positive about Islam, including the Francophile, loved to read French, Archbishop Montini of Milan, Giovanni Battisti Montini, who would be elected Paul VI. Now, Massignon died in October 1962, just as Vatican II was getting underway, but he had enormous impact. And a third thread, so there are these three threads. The major one, you can trace the question on the Jews, the primary effort, all the way to the end, from Jules Isaac to October 28, 1965. But these other two strands, the Asian and African bishops, particularly after the council got underway, saying, wait a minute, we live as minorities among these other religions. There should be an office in Rome for us, for them, to meet here in Rome. Something like 28 new nations came into existence in Africa alone while Vatican II was meeting. This is the extraordinary context. And so people, you know, this was a council process. People were thinking things as the council unwound. And the Asian and African bishops, after just one session, said, no, wait a minute, we have to have more attempts. And then there's a surprise factor, Pope Paul VI, this Montini of Milan. There's Vatican II gathered in St. Peter's. Okay. The two popes of Vatican II. Before and during the conclave that elected Montini in 1963, the bishops from Asia and Africa began to go public with their concern about another secretariat, not just one for Christians or one addressing Jews. From this group, the Cardinal Tien Kiensin of Taipei decided he would write the new Pope Paul, which he did in July of 63. The following September, Pope Paul outlined in a letter to Cardinal Tisserand as Dean of the Cardinals the changes he was going to make in the council. And in one sentence, he declared that in due time, there would be another secretariat, like the Secretariat for Promoting Christian Unity, only a new one that would work for interreligious dialogue. So just like that, as though nothing had happened at the council yet, nobody had any idea that there was even going to be a text. The Pope had already promised a secretariat that would eventually be called non-Christians. So Nostra Aetate would not have happened without Jules Isaac, but there are these other two strands wound in that take on a life of its own, and Paul VI. The strand on Muslims, that's paragraph 3 in the text you have in your hand. The concerns of Asia and Africa bishops, first and second paragraph that you have in your hands. The main thread, paragraph 4 and a lot of 5 on condemning anti-Semitism and all forms of discrimination. Pope Paul VI had a vision of ecumenical and interreligious relations. This is an artist's conception of what a meeting with Pope Paul would look like. There's identifiable figures here: Mohandas Gandhi, the Vietnamese Buddhist Thich Nhat Hanh, the Archbishop of Canterbury, Michael Ramsey, the Metropolitan of Leningrad in those days. Today it's St. Petersburg, Metropolitan Nicodem. There's King Faisal of Saudi Arabia. This event never happened, did it? But this one did. Isn't it interesting? On the 21st anniversary of Nostra Aetate's promulgation, October 28, 1986, John Paul II convened the first World Day of Prayer in Assisi. So the vision of Paul VI came alive. This was the most evident implementation of the Council in the first 20 years after the promulgation. So what did Pope Paul VI do that Pope John did not do? Pope Paul Montini, Fred Israel, Montini, he was already attuned to the needs of a global church. Look at what Pope Paul calls to the bishop's attention in his first address to them as Pope. The Catholic Church looks into the distance beyond the confines of the Christian horizon. How could she place limits on her love if this very love is to be that of God the Father, who showers his favors upon everyone, and who so loved the world that for it he gave his only Son? Look therefore beyond your own sphere and observe those other religions that uphold the meaning of the concept of God as one, creator, provident, most high, and transcendent, that worship God with acts of sincere piety and upon whose beliefs and practices the principles of moral and social life can be found or are founded. This is very different from what they had heard before at Vatican II. Pope Paul also did 2 groundbreaking trips during the Council. The first to the Holy Land in January 1964, and the second to India later in December 1964. In addition, in 1965, September, he went to New York and he addressed the United Nations. He came back from that visit, went right to the council floor, was applauded by the bishops, and he said, "I spoke for you at the UN." It was an act of Vatican II, his speech at the council. So it's more than just 16 documents, of which you hold the shortest. It was more. On his trip to the Holy Land on the Feast of Epiphany, 1964, January 6, in Bethlehem, he formally addressed monotheists, Jews and Muslims. This was the first general invitation to friendship with Jews and Muslims by a pope ever. May the world surrounding us receive today, in the name of Jesus Christ, our respectful and affectionate greeting. We address this reverent greeting in particular to those who profess monotheism and with us direct their religious worship to the one true God, Most High, Living, the God of Abraham, of which all 3 traditions refer, the supreme God whom Melchizedek, a mysterious person, about whose genealogy and end scripture tells us nothing, and by whose regal priesthood Christ himself wishes to be characterized one day, distinct in the past, but recalled in the Bible and in the Missal, and celebrated as God Most High, maker of heaven and earth. So, now this may seem ordinary to you today. This was groundbreaking in 1964. This was extraordinary. He spoke in French, too, as the language of the Holy Land. And don't forget that Pope Paul also established that Secretariat for non-Christians halfway through the council, also on Pentecost, 1964. On Pentecost, Pope John announced the commissions for the council, one of which was the Secretariat for Promoting Christian Unity. In fact, that young Stransky was in church. He heard the announcement. He was with another Paulist. They have a parish in Rome. He said, "Isn't that something? We're involved in ecumenism." No clue that in 3 months he would be on it. Then on Pentecost 1964, he announces a Secretariat for non-Christians. This is Paul VI, John the 23rd, the first, Paul VI. And he said, "Let no pilgrim, no matter how distant that pilgrim is, geographically or religiously from this Rome, ever again be a stranger in this city. You have a place that will welcome you." And then on Pentecost Sunday, on Pentecost, Pentecost in 1986, John Paul II makes clear what he intends to do in Assisi by gathering leaders of the world to walk with him, to keep silent with him, to fast with him, and to pray for peace. So it became part of tradition. Vatican II. One way to One way to look at Vatican II and Nostra Aetate is to look at the various titles the text had through it. The topic was originally questions on the Jews at the first meeting of the Secretariat in November 1960. Then a draft was eventually prepared on the Jews in 1962, but that was withdrawn from the agenda and never saw the light of day. It's an appendix in the preconciliar documentation. Then on relations of Catholics to non-Christians, above all to the Jews, November 63, the first public display of the text on the council floor. Then it was chapter 4 of the decree on ecumenism, of the draft on ecumenism. On the Jews, March 1964, then it was a second appendix to on ecumenism. On the relation of Christians to Jews and to the universal human family, that was a suggestion of the coordinating commission. Let's change the title and expand it. Didn't work. They changed it back to on Jews and on non-Christians, which was then also called the other declaration. So now it's called a declaration and was presented in September 1964. And finally, on the relation of church to non-Christian religions, what you have in your hands. Got its title in November of 64 and was promulgated in October of 65 and was defined in relation to the two constitutions on the church. There are three kinds of documents that the 16 documents of Vatican II are called. There are four constitutions, 9 decrees, and 3 declarations. To say that something is a declaration does not mean that it's less important than a constitution. That's an error. You've got to take the whole collection. And these two declarations, the one on religious liberty, which the Secretariat prepared, and this one, Nostra Aetate, say extraordinarily revolutionary things. So because it's in a declaration doesn't mean it's less important than a constitution. It's just good to know that. Two observations then. That's Rabbi Heschel. Rabbi Abraham Joshua Heschel, a very famous American rabbi who had fled Germany, taught in New York, was very much part of the civil rights movement, walked with Martin Luther King. He was there visiting with Cardinal Bea. Interreligious relations, including relations with Jews, were conceptualized within ecumenical relations. Keep that in mind. You see it, it's a chapter in the text on ecumenism, an appendix, then finally separated as a declaration. That's all a declaration is. It was once part of a decree, but now it's part of a, it's a declaration. That's all. That's the difference. It's in the minutes. You read the council minutes. They're all available. They've been published. Vatican II was only a beginning. Yeah, this is the other point. It couldn't say much about dialogue. It urged it. It used the word throughout. It urged the word throughout. But we're going to go and dialogue, and then we'll know more about it. So it's a text at the beginning. Urged dialogue, but it had more to go. Nostra Aetate survived four major crises. So if I've not complicated it enough with its various titles, let me complicate it by the four crises. Just a few days before the Central Preparatory Commission met in June 1962 to sort through the stack of drafts for the upcoming opening of the council, the World Jewish Congress announced that an Israeli official, Dr. Cham Vardy, would be, who was Israel's minister for Christian affairs, would serve as the observer to the Council for the World Jewish Congress. And Arab governments exploded around the world. Muslim governments exploded. This isn't about the Jews. This is about the Vatican recognizing the state of Israel. This is 1962. State of Israel, 1949. It was an unresolved tension. In fact, I have to say, the Middle East has probably been the central major focus of U.S. foreign policy since 1949. This is pre-67 war. And so it was a highly political issue. And the Secretariat of State said to Beit, we can't do this text. It's too politically hot. It's too hot, too politically hot. We have to take it off the agenda. There was nothing said in the first period of the council. Vatican II met over four fall periods, fall of 62, fall of 63, fall of 64, fall of 65, roughly from either the very end of September or middle October until end of November or no later than December 8th each year. It began preparing in 60, so there's 6 years of preparations, 4 years of meetings, three intercessions. One between 62 and 63, when they did a lot of work. One between 63 and 64, and 64, 65. For the first period, nothing was said about the Jews or interreligious relations in the hall. There were a couple of references, but not of significance. As soon as the bishops went home in December 62, Cardinal Bea wrote to Pope John to restore the idea of a religious statement on relations with Jews to the council. Let's not say anything about politics, nothing about the state of Israel, only that because anti-Semitism has been so horrible, because of the horrors of the Holocaust, because of the terrible charge of deicide, killing God, leveled against Jews for centuries, we've got to address this now. And the Pope wrote right over his memo, Pope John, go ahead. Some would argue that it's impossible to separate religion and politics. You probably would, wouldn't you? We'd have a good debate. I would agree with you. And certainly in the Middle East, you can't separate the two. And that's the problem the Middle East bishops had. In the Middle East, these are not separated. But Bea and Villebrons were successful in promoting the fiction you could keep the two apart. And that's how Nostra Aetate got passed. So as 63 opened, the Secretariat began working on its text on the Jews, but they decided that they would put in a little bit about other religions on the relation of Catholics to non-Christians. All it said was, after we have treated the principles of Catholic ecumenism, we do not wish to pass over and silence the fact that, taking account of diverse conditions, these same principles ought to be applied to the way of conversing and collaborating with those who are not Christians, who nevertheless worship God, or who at least with goodwill strive to follow their conscience in carrying out the moral law which is innate to human nature. Above all, this holds for the Jews, for they are linked to the church in a special way. This text was approved. Let's go back to this. This text was approved, and it was put in the draft on ecumenism. Cardinal Bea presented the draft in November. Bishop said the chapter on the Jews ought to stay part of the draft, but all the time was spent on ecumenism. No time was spent on chapter 4. At the end of the debate, December 3rd, Cardinal Bea thanked everybody. Now look, you didn't discuss chapters 4 and 5. Not discussed, still on the agenda. Pope Paul went to the Holy Land. When he got back, he had a letter from Cardinal Meyer of Chicago. If the last two chapters of the draft on ecumenism, the chapters on the Jews and on religious liberty, are rejected and are not acted upon favorably, Cardinal Meyer worried, I fear very much for the cause of the whole ecumenical movement and for anything that comes out of the council. Furthermore, he predicted, without these two chapters on the Jews and on religious liberty, the cause of the Catholic Church in the United States, and I am afraid, will suffer greatly. Meyer was only one of many bishops who wrote their concern. The Secretariat got to work. It started working on the text. They came up with the text. It went to the Central Commission. And the Central Commission said, well, let's do this and do that. The Pope weighed in with his notes. It was so different from everything that had happened in the past, that what the Secretariat had agreed to, that Cardinal Bea felt obliged in July of 1964 to write to the bishop members of his secretariat, the text you get in the mail isn't the text you approved. The text you get in the mail, after we sent on the Jews as approved by you, the commission began working with it, the coordinating commission. The question may now arise whether or not we can accept this. Can we accept this text or not? I think it's okay. I think it's okay, he thought. However, a draft was leaked to the press with a very bad translation. And it looked like we were promoting dialogue with Jews in the hope that the day would come they would enter the church. So that dialogue with Jews was premised on the idea of leading Jews to becoming Christians. Rabbi Heschel came up with the soundbite of the decade. I'm ready to go to Auschwitz anytime as faced with the alternative of conversion or death. This wasn't the intention of the text. It was a bad text. Was it over? Would it survive this crisis? Cardinal Bea approached the microphone 11 days later, and he received a standing ovation from the bishops. First of all, applause at the beginning of a speech was unusual, but applause was against the council rules. In other words, Cardinal Bea and his secretariat had become the favorites of the council. They presented the text. They heard the comments to expand the text, and they said, we'll be back. No vote is taken. We'll come back and we'll expand the text. And that's what they did. They got a drafting group to come and write the chapter on Muslims. Another drafting group wrote the first two chapters on an introduction, the profound questions we face, the responses of religions in general, naming Hinduism and Buddhism, They got a Jesuit from India, a Jesuit from Japan, from the crowd. They wrote these passages. They preserved relations with Jews as the centerpiece. As they were working on this, Cardinal Bea got a letter from the Secretary General of the Council. We've decided that the text is too cumbersome, so let's break it up. Put part four in the chapter on in the text on the church. We can put one and two and three in the text on missions, and we can put five in the church in the modern world. And Bea said, enough. He stood his ground. I'm not handing this over. The Pope wants us to do it. It's our text. So there was an attempt to take it away. And he won that. They put this text together, presented it to the bishops in November of 1964, and it received considerable approval. They took three votes. Out of about 2,000 fathers voting, on the first three parts, only 136 voted no. On parts four and five, only 185 voted no. On the whole text, 1,651 voted yes, 99 voted no, and 242 voted yes with reservation. So they had some modifications to deal with. Who were the people opposed to the text? Well, there was the minority. Why do we call them the minority? Because there was an overwhelming majority voting yes. And they were people who voted against about all the changes of Vatican II. There were the bishops from the Middle East. Can we even go home if we vote for this text? Bishops from Asia and Africa, is this all we get? One basic line about tribal religion? Well, it's a beginning. They were beginning to be placated. Bishops wanting a more strongly worded text, more condemnatory of the past teaching. And Jewish leaders who did not like the wording. The best book you can buy if you want to catch up on Vatican II is John O'Malley, What Happened at Vatican II. It's a great page turner. He captures this drama I'm trying to give to you. Paul VI did not want the bishops of the Middle East boycotting the text. And their leader, the Melkite, the Eastern Catholic patriarch of our Arab Christian church, Maximus IV, in many ways the enfant terrible of Vatican II. He refused to speak Latin in the hall. He spoke French. Latin's not our language, it's Greek and Arabic. And we speak, we do not speak Latin, so he'd speak French. He threatened to walk out of the hall. Paul didn't want that. Please, we want unity. We don't want to separate the Eastern Catholic bishops, though there's so few. So Cardinal Bea sent two of his staff to the Middle East, and they came back with a dismal story. Very dismal story. They're against this text. There's going to be a boycott. So they had a very hard meeting of the Secretariat, May of 65. Bishop Stangl, Würzburg, said, "Don't leave us on a limb. We have finally begun in Germany the long process of self-examination of the Nazi period. You water down this text, you're going to hurt the German church." This time, Pope Paul sent letters to the Eastern bishops, and more delegates went. They came back with recommendations. They took some, rejected others, but there was placation, and so the text survived its final crisis. This is the man who did it, and he was in his 80s, and he didn't live long afterwards. It was presented in mid-October 1965, and this time there were several votes taken, but there you have it. That part one, only 116. The Paul wanted no more than 400 negative votes. He only got 245 on the section on the Jews out of 2023 voting. And then it was promulgated with a formal vote and only 88 negative votes. On the 15th of October, after the first voting, this Father Stransky, with whom I've been working, I've known him since 1981, when I met Father Bruce, who's sitting here too. We are all at a conference together. But for the last 9 years, we've been working on this story and getting his account out. He said to the press, "What is said in this declaration may seem naive in centuries to come." So when you read it, it may sound naive and simple, but at present, it would be difficult for the council to come up with more. The second point I want to make is you should take the whole of Vatican II together. Don't isolate sentences from this text. Don't isolate this text from the rest of Vatican II. Number three, Nostra Aetate encourages a positive view of others, but does not address the question of the role of other religions in salvation. Nostra Aetate instructs Catholics to recognize and preserve and foster the good things that are found in other religions through dialogue and the like, but no advice on how spiritual sharing takes place. Nostra Aetate 3, you know, there are various questions that it asked and answered. There's questions that it raised, but it could not answer, and there's questions not even asked. Nothing is said about the Holocaust. Nothing is said about the state of Israel. Part three talks about some beautiful things about the faith of Muslims, but Muslims read it and say, it doesn't mention the Quran and the prophecy of Muhammad. These are kind of important to us. It does mention 3.5 of the 5 pillars, that they believe in the one God, it doesn't say, and Muhammad is his prophet. Salat, Zakat, and Shom are all mentioned with respect. Nothing is said about pilgrimage. One reason, why didn't John the 23rd, he was in Turkey. He forged dozens, if not hundreds, of baptismal certificates, marriage certificates, and saved many Jews passing out of Europe to Palestine. Why didn't he think? Well, this, Adolf Eichmann, arrested and tried in 61. It was not until the Eichmann trial, the public trial in the state of Israel, not just that the world knew, but that the survivors began talking, because they didn't. There were only one or two books out on the Holocaust by 1961. They were too negative. Publishers didn't want to publish them. But it was with the Eichmann trial, things changed. That's context. John Paul II is the one who addressed the Holocaust with his famous prayer placed in the wall, asking the forgiveness of God for all that Christians have done against Jews. And Pope Francis, in his visit. Nothing is said about the civil rights movement, except in the Church of the Modern World, but this was happening at the same time. This was happening at the same time, too, the Cuban Missile Crisis. As the Council got underway, the world almost ended with nuclear war. Pope John was instrumental in breaking the peace, getting the peace into place, breaking the impasse into peace, because he sent a positive word to Khrushchev. And if Khrushchev said, if the Pope is addressing me, that's a victory. And then Pope John said to his priest Pietro Pavan, I want you to write a text that Nikita Khrushchev and John Kennedy will read. And that was Peace on Earth, the encyclical Pacem in Terris. That happened during the council. So many things were context. So many things going on at the time. It's a very complicated journey. You know, the Cold War, the Middle East, trial of Eichmann, Cuban Missile, the end of colonialism, war in Southeast Asia, the assassination of the self-immolation of the Buddhist monk Thich Quang Duc. I know how to pronounce Vietnamese. You kind of get it, you know? I had an expense-paid vacation in 1970 and all the green clothes I wanted to wear. But Pope John was welcomed at the Rome Synagogue in 1986, and Pope Francis, with his friend Rabbi Skorka, sits among the rabbis. That's the world we live in, thanks to this text, and thank you.
Back to the choir from St. Martin's. So if there's any brief questions, anyone want to, observations or questions, anyone like to ask?
Observations, questions? Yes.
Curious, what guidance do you see from this document or declaration, particularly now at a time of growing anti-Islamophobia?
Right.
This text launched us into a world, as Catholics, into a world of interreligious relations. The same principles apply to Muslims that applied to Jews. We used to accuse all Jews of the death of Jesus, not just Jews who lived at the time of Jesus, but Jews today. The same kind of general dismissal of peoples and is condemned by the text. And the willingness to see that Muslims are people of faith as we are and believe in the one God. I mean, this is clear in the text, but Pope John Paul II had to restate it, that Muslims worship the one God as we do. And so despite the fact that we have these political entities today that try to speak for the Islam and for all Muslims, Islam is not as organized as a Christian church, so who speaks for Islam? And so part of that effort is how to gain the voice for Muslims to be heard. Another thing is that the text speaks religiously, but in fact, politics and religion are intertwined. So that we have to understand that there are really two kinds of dialogue going here. There's the accompaniment of faith that we can have with all people of faith because we share many of the same concerns and the values. And we can talk our daily problems with each other and learn from one another when we draw from our spiritual resources and share them. This is Pope Francis, accompaniment. We're all going on the way together. Then there is the kind of public discourse that takes place in the public square, where you're not taking the time of this intense accompaniment, but you're trying to build coalitions. And you've got to understand the political context. You know, you have to understand, well, why couldn't this text say something about the state of Israel? It doesn't even use the word Israel, because for fear that at that time, so many people who felt that the state of Israel had been imposed on Palestine, on the Arab peoples, was an unresolved political issue, which very much remains today. In 1993, the Vatican recognized the state of Israel and the Kingdom of Jordan and started trading ambassadors. That was a long time after Nostra Aetate. I think we have to keep in mind the two kinds of discourse, the kind of communion discourse that we have with people of faith as spiritual accompaniments, and the kind of public discourse where our friends, our Muslim friends, are getting their voice. They're organizing themselves. I actually think American Muslims will be leaders in this for the rest of the world because they know they have a special place and they can talk about the intersection of living in a religiously plural world and the survival of Islam, because their history is no different than any of our communities. In fact, they look at Catholics as the examples they want to emulate. They like to have all those Supreme Court justices, you know. He didn't make a public apology for the Holocaust. He asked God's forgiveness for all the sins of Christians against Jews. Jewish leaders were very clear that they didn't want an apology because they felt they didn't have a right to receive it in the name of all who have perished. And so what's happening now is there's a joint Christian-Jewish effort in discovering the dimensions of the Holocaust. And a French priest, Father Dubois, has been researching what he calls the Holocaust by bullets. Before there was Auschwitz and Birkenau and the other prison camps, the death camps, Jews were killed by bullets. Trenches were dug and whole villages were slaughtered and then buried. And they're going back and recovering these villages, these death sites, and finding that there's a lot more. The dimension was even greater. And there, this forensic evidence identifying the victims, getting people in the village to talk about that event. So it's a matter of us coming to terms with owning that event and owning that history. By the way, another event that happened during Vatican II was that the Deputy premiered in Berlin in 1963, which was the play that accused Pius XII of complicity with the Nazis. It's a very difficult spot. Did Pius XII do enough during the war? One thing he did is that he opened all the houses in Rome. A lot of Jews hid in the cellars of the colleges, the convents, the houses of priests. In those days, if your brother or sister was in a religious order, you didn't stay overnight where they lived. And this was a big deal. I mean, they opened there, and many Jews found refuge there. But the worry was that if the Pope spoke, that the Nazis would move on the Vatican. He even had a letter that if he's ever arrested, he was resigning the papacy so that they wouldn't have the Pope. That was already written. And that it would bring merciless persecution to Catholics in Germany and elsewhere. And so the dimensions of this are great. And a simple apology just doesn't work. It's a matter of owning that history and coming to it's what Georgetown's going right through right now in terms of its own history and the sale of Africans, slaves, who were working here on the Eastern Shore in their plantations. And so it's a matter of coming to terms with that history. So I think that's what he did, and that's what his note said that he placed in the wall in Jerusalem, asking the forgiveness of God for all that Christians have done against Jews. So.
Thank you, Dr. Thank you very much. I'd like to bring to the podium my friend Cantor Alan Haber, who is a very distinguished vocalist who sings at observances of the High Holy Days across the country and has a special relationship with Temple B'nai Israel in Easton and its Rabbi Peter Hyman, who is here with us this evening. So, my good friend, Alan Haber.
It is my pleasure and my honor to bring back up the St. Martin's Catholic Church, gospel, choir, and band, led by the powerful Cantor Aetate. Thank you.
nations.
I'm the glory above the nations.
Give God the highest praise, acknowledging him always. And all the people say, Alle, Alle, Alleluia.
Alle,
Alle, Alleluia.
Alle,
Alle, Alleluia.
Alle,
Alle, Alleluia. Give God the highest praise, acknowledging him always. And all the people say, Alle, Alle, Alleluia.
Alle,
Alle, Alleluia.
Alle,
Alle, Alleluia.
Alle,
Alle, Alleluia.
Alle, Alle, Alleluia.
Oh, Alle.
Hallelujah!
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 prayer that we sing at the end of many Jewish services. Adon Olam.
The Lord Eternal reigned before the birth of every living thing is the first line. The last line is, God is with me, I shall not fear. Body and spirit in his keep. Those are the words. The melody is I Saw the Light, Hank Williams, 1948. Mm-hmm. Ready, Terrence?
Ready.
Adon Olam, Asher Molach, Viterem Kol, Yitzir Nivra. Liyed nasa v'chetz hakol Azay melech shimo nikro Adon Olam Adon Olam Hashem Biterem kol Yitzin ifra Liyed nasa v'chetz hakol Azay melech shimo nikro Adon V'yacharei kichlot hakol levado yimloch nora v'hu haya v'hu hove v'hu hiye v'tifara Adon
Sing it now.
Adon Hashem olach b'terem kol yitzin ivra
One more time now.
Adon Olam, Hashem Olam, B'terem Kol, Yitzir Nivra, Liyed Naso, V'chetz Hakol, Zay Melech Shimo Nivra, Adon Olam, V'hu Eli, V'chago Ali,
I lie. Shalom Aleinu, V'al Kol Yisrael V'yiru Amen. May the one who makes peace in heaven above bring that peace down here on earth. Spread it all around to all Israel, to all the world, and let us say Amen. You may recognize this melody. Oh, say shalom.
Oh,
say shalom. give you three breaths. This is our last song. And while it's not a religious song, it's a spiritual song, because it's a song that believes in hope and in optimism. And it was written by the Lamed Vav Pete Seeger in 1969. And the title is called Quite Early Morning. And it's an interesting phrase that someone had, a friend of his coming from Great Britain, had come to visit, and there was a lot of rushing around and to get ready for different travel arrangements. And this fellow was just kind of very calm and right in the middle, and everybody was rushing around. And he said, you know, it's going to be too late, it's going to be too late. And he said, I don't understand. There's plenty of time. It's quite early morning. And that phrase stuck with Pete. And in 1969, when people were still sweeping out their bomb shelters, and before global warming, they still thought that the world was going to come to an end for other reasons. He wrote this song, and I'm going to start it. I'm going to repeat the last phrase of each verse, and I'd like you to sing it with me. Okay? Don't you know it's darkest before the dawn? And it's this thought keeps me moving on. If we could heed these early warnings, the time is now, quite early morning. If we could heed won't long endure, but what makes them so very sure? We know that you who hear our singing could make those freedom bells go ringing. While we live, until we have no more to give, and when our voices can sing no longer, there will be voices younger, stronger,
and when our voices
can sing no longer,
there will be
stronger.
So though it's darkest before the dawn, these thoughts keep us moving on. Through all this world of joy and sorrow, we still can have singing tomorrows.
Through all this world,
tomorrow.
Thank you so very much. What an amazing event. Thank you also very much for being with us this evening. Keep in mind our next event on Tuesday, May the 3rd, on religion and architecture. And please join me again in thanking Dr. Borelli and thanking Alan Haber and thanking our very dear friends from St. Martin's. Thank you so much.